for you all to today's Merseytravel committee. Terms of apologies for absence from Councillor Mark Norris, we received apologies for. Obviously, in terms of declaration of interest, if there is anything that needs to declare either now or later during the terms of the meeting, please don't hesitate to shout. We'll fulfill out the relevant paperwork accordingly. Third item is the minutes of the last meeting. So if I can move that the minutes of the last meeting, subject to amendment in minute 78 to change the name of David Print to Print, which is Merseytravel's employee's actual name, if that's agreed with everyone. Item 4, Tony.
I move the proceedings of the Audit and Governance Sub-Committee held on the 24th of November 2014.
That's agreed. Oh, can you just do item B as well, guys?
Advise the committee that clarification have been sought for the internal confidential reporting policy of the Committee to Merseytravel Board for approval, reflecting any comments raised.
That's all agreed?
Agreed.
Excellent. Item 5, Ken.
Thanks, Neil. I'm pleased to move the proceedings on the performance and review subcommittee as of the 24th of November.
Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Item 6, if I can move the proceedings of the General Purposes Subcommittee held on the 27th of November, if that's agreed.
Agreed.
Excellent. Okay, on to the meat in the sandwich, if you like. last month we had our first operator presentation from Merseytravel, and I'm very pleased to welcome Phil and Howard from Arriva to give us their presentation today. So if we can have theirs, we can let them go through it in totality first, and then we'll take questions afterwards.
Right, it's afternoon everybody. I'm Phil Stone, I'm the regional MD of Arriva. Howard Farrall is the area MD for the Merseyside. And Phil's our engineering director across the region as well. I thought we'd just give you a bit of background to Arriva, who owns us, how big we are, but obviously the meeting is about being from Merseyside. So you'll get the presentation, I won't go into loads and loads of detail about it. We're owned by Deutsche Bahn, which is the German state railway. Deutsche Bahn is just huge, it runs about 130 countries, turns over about £40 billion a year, worth about 300,000 euros. Massive organisation. It bought us in 2010, and I've got to say, that's been a really good thing. Skeptical about it, it's probably useful. You guys are skeptical about it, but as far as I'm concerned, Deutsche Bahn, as you can see off there, I'm sure you'll have a look at it, is the biggest rail infrastructure in Europe, the biggest rail operation in Europe, the second biggest bus operation in Europe. Logistics in the world is the biggest. It's, you know, you'll never look at those stats, it's a massive logistics operation. More about that Arriva, and again I won't go through the stats on it, you can have a look at them yourself. Arriva is the arm of Deutsche Bahn outside Germany, so Arriva is all about investing in and expanding Deutsche Bahn across Europe. And again, they're probably going to look at the Middle East, they're looking at South America, they're looking all around the world, there's good opportunities. Again, Arriva itself turns over £4 billion a year, so it's a pretty meaty operation. And you can see off the map, it's a lot of countries, it's 14 countries around Europe, so it's a pretty big organisation. So perhaps taking questions, but I don't go into detail. That's Arriva North West of Wales, six of us locally, three of us are here in one company. Under, I suppose, my leadership, we also have an MD in Wales, we also have an MD in Manchester, who also powers the government in those areas, finance director, engineering director, etc. That's our region. We turn over 163 million turnover, about 1,200 buses, 2,700 drivers, other admin staff, about 14 garages. On the top of those garages we have outstations, particularly in places like Anglesey, the deli, places like that. wait, I'll let Phil talk about it tonight, just in case it's
that's good. Just to move on with the fleet, you can see the 240 on vehicles from the 600 plus the floods mentioned already. We've invested in over the last few years in Merseyside alone. That's been an investment of over £40 million. That's the average fleet age. Pretty standard actually now for the investment we've put into the city. So we've got an average fleet age of 6.7 from the current investment that's coming into the city right now. We're literally just taking delivery of a brand new fleet. So which ones are all on the road in March, the fleet age will be down to 6.7 years. And that's just a summary of the fleet really, the age profile, the way we've obviously measured it, not just the 15-year rule, station, also for our DDA achievement, which comes into force later next year. And literally, we're on track. So we've got 48 vehicles coming into the fleet at the moment, with another 60 towards the back end of next year. So we're on track, no problem at all for us in achieving our DDA requirements. Speaking again about the investment, if you've been anywhere near Speaker or Leap recently, John Lennon, you will notice the new vehicles that are operating from Speed Depot into the city centre. And if you travel on the 10 route into the city from St. Helens, there's a full fleet of vehicles, 37 in total, from the 10s, 10As and 10Bs, which are to hit the road from the 1st of January. And that's rolled on throughout January, actually the 1st of February. So a full new fleet. And also Route 53 in Bootle, which we've seen the 16 new defects as well. With regard to the environment, a ring ratchet purchased a company called Zeta Automotive, or 51% share of it. And this is an electronic device that if you're ever stuck behind a white van that says this bus or this van is limited to 62 miles an hour, it's usually because of this device. It controls the acceleration, deceleration of the vehicle through the accelerator, And we've invested into 51% of this company. And the projection is that it will give us about 5% saving on our fuel. Invested in gas buses in Runcorn, they operate from Runcorn around Busway and into Liverpool on weekends. Hybrids, you'll see all the vehicles that we operate primarily through the toll, and now the hybrid with the vets. And more recently, we were successful with the Clean Bus Fund through Merseytravel and DFT for clean exhaust systems, which moved a number of our vehicles from Euro 3 to Euro 5 emission technology. I'll just pass you over to Howard to talk about people.
Good afternoon. Just a little bit about what we do with our people. Obviously we've got 2,500 staff, which is quite a lot. You'd be amazed at how many of those staff that's in long service. We do long service awards every year. There's probably about 150, 160 staff each year. We do more than 20, 25, 30, 35. In fact, we've got three this year that have actually got 50 years service, which is quite incredible So we do a lot for the long service awards. We also got 20 apprentices that have started with us with Phil in the engineering, we've got a couple of graduates as well, because we're obviously very keen to keep the skills in-house to make sure that when we have people retiring, we've got the skills behind. We do a lot with IIP champions now in all six guises in Merseyside. In fact, in the company now, in all 14 garages, we've reached that status. And very recently, I wish the young manager of the year was the one on the right, which not, it's the one on the left, is Richard Hall, who we're very proud of, and won that right throughout the UK, so it's a great achievement. So it just gives you a flavour of some of the things that we do with regards to staff. As regards to the partnership, there are two main things that we've been doing in the recent years. One is BBF, which is Better Bus Early Fund for those that don't know. We're in partnership with, of course, Merseytravel, Holden, Knowsley and St Helens. And it's about trying to, bums on seats is the main sort of theory behind it. It's how we work together collaboratively in making sure that we deliver better service to our customers. So some of the ideas that we're looking at, we've just agreed quality partnership timetable with Holden on the 17th of 33, where all our tickets will be available between both operators and this certainly helps give the customer what they want, which is they don't have to worry about which bus they can get on. So there, some of the things we're looking at: traffic signals, bus priorities, and it's a 3-year period. When the DfT came out to see us, there's 3 of them in the country, and we are well ahead of the other two. So I think that's great credit to both the staff at Merseytravel, but also Holt and St Helens and Rosely and the operators as well. So just a little bit about the VPA. Where are we as far as the VPAs are concerned? For those of you who don't know, we committed to VPAs in 2011. The 14th service was the first one. As you can see from the list, the operators have ticked off all of what they were supposed to do. So there's a data sharing agreement, joint publicity, continuous availability of tickets, and all those routes. There's also been investment in vehicles and all those routes. So hopefully in the future, we'll be able to get down as a statutory party partnerships. At the moment, they're just voluntary partnerships at the moment. As you can see, a lot of work's gone into it. We've been running for 3 years. My only regret is I wish we could have sung the dance about them a little bit earlier, but hopefully in the future we can put that right.
Smart cards, we introduced student smart cards at the university last year. You can see we've got somewhere in the region of 16,000 tickets on smart in Merseyside by the university students. That's our own ticket. We've obviously been fully involved with all the smart cards as well, so that went live the week last month, 2 weeks ago. And obviously we're fully involved with that. We have invested in ticket machines. We have had to get our technical people very, very involved. We are very committed to getting this going. We all think smart cards are thinking the future is a good thing. I think we're happy to go forward. We have to just put the pleasant improvements in there before we go through it. But you know, we're happy to go ahead and say the way it appears to be working. So that's kind of it. I think the technical issues seem to have been resolved. That was 1 or 2 in the first week. We don't see them. So we're happy to put that right across the business side. And hopefully over the day, particularly concerned. I don't think anybody's been happy with that role, because we've never been happy for years and years. We're able to scrape away the same way to be concerned. Hopefully that's a good thing, and we're happy to go forward with it. I'm not going to comment very much on this one, but obviously the bus lanes issue, we're quite public in the press, weren't we? You know, all bus journeys in Merseyside are actually 1% slower than that 12-month vehicle. Or car journeys were 1% smaller. I've got to say the third one was really, really important. Our reliability was not worse by 20%, it was more erratic by 20%. So that is what puts the passengers on travel. Now I think it's great that the 4-city centre ones have gone back in. It would be really, really interesting how the city goes for the next month or two. So we still believe bus priorities are really important. What will move the city on? Passengers are increased passengers in the city. It's making bus quicker than the car. I don't know if people in the room have cars. It is very hard to get people to public transport. But it's quicker, it's cheaper, you don't have to park. All those issues, you will attract people onto cars. It's not onto buses. I don't think people have this talk without talking about franchising as well. And we work all around Europe. We are actually the third biggest operator in London. We have about a third of the market. So we're not used to franchising. We franchise all around Europe. It's something that we focus on. I think we've got a realistic argument that London's different. The funding is totally different. There's a number up there about £75 subsidy per person in London compared to about £19 outside. There's a lot of money involved. Buses are new, they're nearly all less than 5 years old. There's a lot of hybrids down there. There's also very good bus lanes and bed routes. It's very expensive parking down there. There's congestion charging. Everything forces people out of cars onto buses. And it still gets subsidised for £500 million a year. So I found that really hard actually. I'd like to ask to subsidise that much. But we've been with Merseytravel, we've worked with Merseytravel for years and years and years. BBAS, BPAs, sorting out
I think it's highlighted a little bit more on the next slide. That's what's happened in the last 4 years, from 2011, 12, 13, and 14. Yes, the single fare has gone up 180 to 220. Yes, the weekly ticket went from 17 to 18, then dropped to 15, and has held for the last 2 years. And the Liverpool zone ticket has held for last year at £4. Now, interestingly, those figures alongside the single correlate to this graph that we'll show you next, which is that. So when we get criticised for putting the Gallup single from 210 to 220, only 9% of our people actually buy the Gallup single. The rest are all made up from day, weekly, concessionary pass, the off bus that we get from Merseytravel, and all our off bus online, like M tickets, student tickets, and everything else that goes offline. So yes, whilst we agree the flat fare, we believe, has reached a peak, it's got to be something that we look at, because we're conscious of the fact that £2.20 from Speak to Liverpool may be reasonable, but £2.20 going three stops is not. And I don't think that you would get any argument from us behind here. So I suppose the question's got to be, what are we doing about it? So I'm going to show you something that is a top secret. These are the sort of fare initiatives that we've been looking at and that we've done over the last couple of years. We took a big risk on the £15, because originally it was just valid in the Liverpool zone. We increased it to cover the whole of Merseyside. And in fairness, what's happened on the Whittle is that patronage has grown. So that was a good start. We introduced the child ticket to £10 in April 2013. Because there wasn't a child version, but the adult version, and that's worked. The My Ticket was introduced in May 2014 in partnership with Merseytravel and the other operators, and at the moment we are selling 25,000 tickets a week on that, which is quite a lot, to be fair, from something that's just started in May. However, as you just point out, that there has been an effect in the off-bus lanes because the child Safeway ticket was dropped. So there's still a balance to be drawn between whether or not it's actually grown or it's just flatlined. And at the moment, those discussions are still ongoing. Some of the other things that we've looked at, the £3 return on the belt, see whether that would help get away from the 220. But I think the big thing for us will be April next year, when we introduce short hopper. We're going to trial it on the Whittle. There's going to be two things. We're going to trial it on the Whittle, where there'll be a £1.50 short hopper. And also, we're looking, I haven't cut this up because it's only just been ratified, that we're going to be looking at an off peak ticket between 9:30 and 3:00 at £1.50 as well, to try and generate where we may have sort of capacity in between weeks after about 9:30. So hopefully there are some of the fair initiatives that you can see that we're looking at. But it's about a controlled risk, so we can judge what's happening and whether it's worked or not. Just a little bit about marketing, about what we do, and about fares. Obviously, you'll know that all the new vehicles that come into the fleet have e-leather seats and Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is extremely popular, especially with the student market in Liverpool. I haven't got the figures, but it's about 30,000 a week, I think, that use the Wi-Fi, so it's incredible on usage. Some of the other stuff we've done is we've looked at £10 a week on sort of service 10, and the big one is the app. We've now got an app that's got real-time information on that hopefully, you know, will help our customers at least understand where the bus is. It's got the information on the next slide, there it is. 350,000 downloads, and we found that two-thirds of our customers actually go back and have become regular users, which is really, really good. And our customer services are now handling over 110 live chats a day with our customers. So again, it's more interaction, it's making it easier for the customer to be able to understand where the service is, what the delays are, and and how they can buy their tickets. And this is something that we're trying to develop on the website. We know it's not a finished article. There's still things that are missing there, but we're trying to make it a lot easier for our customers to buy the tickets, understand what the prices are, what's best for them, what service updates we've got, the weather, things like the weather, how that can affect it, especially tomorrow morning. We've already sent weather warnings out to our customers on the website because there's a possibility of snow at 5 o'clock in the morning. So they're the sort of things that we're looking at to try and give as much information as we possibly can. Social media obviously plays a big part. We've now got just short of 5,000 Twitter followers. We get 15,000 tweets, and we've got 4,500 people on the, Facebook. And again, it's a very important sort of medium because it allows us to communicate any messages that we want to get out to our customers about bad weather or about diversions or about road closures that happen due to accidents. Straight away, we can get the information out, and we've got a dedicated team in Aintree to work on this every single day. So again, it's about getting that information out to more and more people, more and more of the customers. And hopefully, the real-time information on the app will help us. Thought I'd just finish, my part anyway. The latest surveys have come out. These are the customer surveys. And as you can see on the graph, we are 94% who are satisfied, extremely satisfied with the service that we get in sort of Merseyside. And that's been consistent for the last 10 years. And that ranks probably in the top five in the UK. So, you know, I think that's a really good result. A little bit about passenger focus, again, when they did it for Merseytravel. Again, we were with the joint highest PTE area, I think we're northeast, Tyne and Wear, were 85%. So again, I think that's a great credit to the partnership that we have with Merseytravel, and hopefully following the next results, which are July, we'll be able to sort of maintain that or even go one step further and better it. A little bit about what we do in the community, because obviously we've got the 2,500 staff. We do a lot in the community, and perhaps we don't shout about it enough. Bottom left is the Knowsley Citizens of Awards, which are a fantastic event. They're held annually. They're about kids that have done great things during the year, whether it be at school or whether it be at home, and there are some fantastic stories that there really are. Then we do the football teams, we do men's teams, kids teams, we do girls teams, we do a lot around the area, and of course we do a lot for Zoe's Place. As you can see, the bus, we did that as a partnership form because we've been with them now for over 10 years. And of course we did the Giants, where we had the Giants sitting on the top of the Arriva bus, and that was fantastic. It was a fantastic bus for our staff, it was fantastic for the driver who actually drove it, and it was just a great event. Got a lot of good credit for it. It was very worthwhile, and it was great for the city, more importantly.
So these are our priorities. Obviously, I think you'll tell us your priorities in a minute, but I think the quality of the place is important. The cleaning standards, we've definitely gone through a bit of a rocky patch over the last year, so we're fit to get out of that new contractor in IT, and we are definitely concentrating on the cleaning standards. Drives and all our servers actually part really, really well. But you know, that's a new accounting group that we're all going through today's training now, customer service, dealing with accidents, all those sort of issues. So we continue to push the standard of our drives. The investment, how was already said, it really continued. But I think what you're going to see is a lot more double deckers in the city, a lot less single deckers. When we bought Mersey Bus 2000, we had lots of problems on double deckers. We made a decision then to bring single deckers in and really get rid of the double deck fleet. I think we've changed that and we're going to have a lot more deckers in now. So you'll see the 53 coming in January and February, and you'll see quite a lot more in the end of next year as well. So the single deckers are disappearing.
priority everybody talks about, that's got to be a big priority in the next one. It's got to be a big priority in collaboration with you guys. But it's sort of make that work. I think our view is that should be all transport in the city. We're not getting to the road until the railways come on it, until the ferries come on it, the trains come on it, the lots. We want everybody to smart cars. We're happy to go on that. Again, I'll lobby for bus priorities. You know, we will get people out of cars onto buses if we can get the speed of transport. We've got to carry on lobbying for bus priorities. Better information, better marketing, working with yourselves again to get better information out to people. We've got to try and improve that again. You only have to go on holiday, don't you? And you get to the airport and you don't have to get somewhere. What they end up doing, you get a taxi. Somehow we've got to get better information into the city. The app's helping that bit, but it's a lot further than that. And I think people continue bottom of the push margin. We're happy to include you guys. Generally, we have a good relationship with Merseytravel, which I'm happy to work with. We do full application, but most things go over this area. There's lots of things we've done over the last 5-6 years that have improved that market. So, that's us. Happy for questions, mate.
Lovely, thanks for that, gents. That's very useful. No doubt that'll stimulate a lot of questions and discussions. Before we launch into that, I know the two panels have got to be away at half past because they've got a train to. Longer than that. Before I open up to everyone else, there's one thing I was going to kick off with. You mentioned, Phil, how it's very hard to convert people into bus users. I think we need to qualify that a little bit in the sense that we've been doing some internal marketing and we know that about 21% of our local population are regular public transport users, the majority of those bus users. We also then know that another 26% of the local population say they would happily convert if they thought the offer was right for them. And I think that really is quite a tantalising and encouraging prize. So with everything that you've said, can you tell us how you're kind of pulling together all of those things and a growth strategy really to tap into those people that are more amenable before we think about those people who are a bit more challenging to get out?
I think the growth strategy is the investment. We still have got some older buses out there, I'm not going to deny that, some 13, 14 year old buses, they will be gone in some next certain city, something like that. So it's getting the course of this week really, really good. We've got some initiatives, and there's one, really, really one in the area, there's going to be a couple, one in the area of Ashton South, to work into a scanner scale, a satellite project. And when we do that, when we put Wi-Fi on, good information out there, good marketing there, buses actually, I like always brand new buses that have just been refurbished, really bad. We've seen really big increases in that. So, standard of fleet and better information is a big one. The app, obviously, should help people to know when the bus is about to turn up. Seriously, go and have a look at the app. Stand at the bus stop, it will tell you where all our buses are on time, late, early. You can look on the map, press on the bus, it will tell you when the next bus is about to arrive. Not scheduled data, generally it's live data. I think the last one, and we have got to be careful, we've reduced what will be a £19.50 ticket now to £15.60. I think that competes pretty well with any other city in the country. So we've got £15 weekly ticket, we've got £4 daily ticket, and as Howard said before, we've got we accept this. You seem high for short haul. Let's increase the quality. Let's make it all very
answer your first question, Rob. Working out the balance and Southport, something historical affairs are different. I'll give you one example. Working out the balance, I think we're all cost of the tunnel. So, over the last 5 years, what we've been trying to do is we had about 10 different fairs, now we've got it down to 3. I think the intention is to do exactly what we've done with Liverpool, Birkenhead, St Albans and Southport. It just takes a little bit of time. Because obviously, whatever you do, there'll be an element of risk, because some will lose and some will gain. So it's how we manage that risk in order to try and get one fair along the Merseyside. Because it isn't just about a flat fare. It's like we talked about before, £2.20 for 3 stops. There's a lot of money. So at the same time, we want to be looking at introducing. That's why we're trialing it, so we can control it. The thing about the kids is you might be in school, leaving age is going up to 18, and it may well probably be that in time we will have to move our child under 16 to under 17 and then under 18 to be able to match it. But again, I would say that there's a risk to that, because if you look at the students, what people forget is that our students pay when they buy their 3 monthly tickets or their annual tickets, they pay £1.20 a day. So all they pay a day's travel. That's how cheap the student tickets are. So we've got to be a little bit careful. We can increase the buy ticket to under 17 if that's what we want to do. There's no reason why we couldn't look at doing that. But again, it's just understanding what that risk is. And at the moment, we haven't got the answer to the under 16s. So I think we would agree it's going to move that way, I think, in time. I think we've just got to understand from both sides what the risk is.
Yeah, just back off on that. I appreciate the value of your tickets and something that you can afford to buy.
Stand here and say it's going to happen tomorrow, but I don't think it's going to be 25 years. I think that all the operators right throughout the country are already in discussion about what they do with kids' fares and about whether they move it to 17 or 18 at this stage. I think it will happen in the next 12 months, in my own opinion. But again, I would like to stand here and sort of commit that my ticket increase to under 17s, it may, but it may not do. But I think what we've got to understand first is what it's doing to the under 16 market. Because, like I just explained to you, yes, we sell a lot on bus, but it's what's happening to the off bus that's involved as well. So I think, yeah, I agree with you. As far as I'm concerned, we should be encouraging kids as much as we can at 17 and 18 to get the bus, because then hopefully they won't buy cars. Once you've got them at 18, the hope is that you'll keep them forever.
Okay, thanks for that. I've got Tony next, then Gordon, then Jeremy, then Marlene, then Mary.
Thanks, Chair. The
savings, so they're not likely to be passed on to those students.
It's quite interesting, when we looked at the Irish, generally, it should be people who are going to be around for the bus. Now, I guess pretty important actually. with, I'm not going to agree with what I say, but we're late 2 minutes, 3 minutes every time. People get used to that. So people have got that certainty and they know exactly when that bus is going to turn up. I think people are going to use that. I've got to say, all the feedback I've heard from that is it's pretty positive. And it is easy. I think we're going to end up adding furs on the back of that. Sure, we've ever taken it for we don't do things like canal restores and things like that, but obviously we could extend that to that sort of community support. So if you go into more of the country areas and certain adults get stones, they literally do put the buses through an app and say we need to wheelchair one is interesting. Really said when it was lost by first group, it really wasn't the driver's responsibility to effectively keep the person down. That was what was appealing. And it's very hard for a driver to get out of the car and have a confrontation with the passenger. And it's their responsibility to actually say, you've got to get off this bus and you've got to get this wheelchair. So it would probably be appealing again because the group. Try hard to persuade the ladies with problems or people with problems to put the problems down. But at the end of the day, it's not their responsibility. So our drivers have got to try. We should always do that. The view from the drivers is usually you're the passenger on the bus, more important than that. Instead, we put the problems down and say we're the person who's on it. But it's very hard for our drivers to have that confrontation. We say that to get out of his seat. Wasn't only there, I walked down the bus and had a big confrontation with a passenger. It's hard. Before we had more slow buses, we still can do this. You can in theory bring the deck up and say, I am coming onto this bus at 10 past 2 and I need to go forward. I need to go to my good shift. Now, in theory, you can still do that, but probably realistically, it doesn't happen. There's no reason why that.
Second point is we have had agreements in the past with certain organisations where we do allow carers to go for free. Normally it's done at a group level, they tend to write it to group and it becomes a policy. And I know in years gone past we did do something with the blind people, but I think the guide dogs travel free, but we have done for carers in the past. It's not, I've got to be honest, it's not something that's
risen
to
town,
but it's something that
we'll
look at.
Very sorry to interrupt, but some people find that I've had people confused now with the lights on, the chair, or the bus chair. The fact is, vehicles have moved right now, that comes from the iPhone, the central Google, there's no
right,
lights, there's a wheelchair, and they explain.
that's absolutely right. The point I was trying to make is if they did give up their space, it didn't have to go off the bus.
Yeah,
the case was about wasn't the driver's responsibility to deal with that issue. And the answer would be they've got to try hard to sort it out. At the end of the day, the driver cannot be sued because we have not got that space for that much of a project.
I think fundamentally the case is proceeding to the Supreme Court, obviously we'll give finality to it, so let's wait until we've got that judgment. I've not gotten Jeremy next, then Marlene, then Mary, then Mal and Dan. Then John.
Thank you, Chair. My ticket has been a great success. This was brought up before, but I think it's really important to do something for those aged 16 to 18 as soon as possible. This is just by extending my ticket. Your comments, please.
We think it's a bit early to actually say my ticket is a great success. About the first time, a lot of those people have actually transferred across from cash or transferred across from the child so on our service. And our reimbursement from that, which is always actually 2 or 3 months behind, has absolutely collapsed. So overall, as our revenue overall increase, we are not sure. Have our passenger numbers overall increased? We are not sure. The only time we are sure is at the weekend, so there's no doubt there's a lot of tickets being sold on Saturday and Sunday. Massive amounts of services. So the success of my ticket has been a good thing. Now we've brought in the schools. Now, I think we all feel it is a success. We just need to go through the process of bringing it to us. And I think we'll all be doing that with time. And if you think about it, tickets, the same way we sold tickets, we actually sold in September. We are just about getting paid for it now. So we don't really know what those ticket sales are going to be like. So I feel it is. I mean, we're not far. We need another 2 or 3 months to say, yes, it's really, really worth it. But the initial look at it is we are not increasing revenue, or particularly increasing investment. But we're not sure. So we'll come back to you. As I'm sure Merseytravel will in 2 or 3 months back.
So by Easter, we'll be in a position to see where things can see.
Yeah.
Okay, right.
I think
we'll have that. Note that. Next up is Marley.
Liam mentioned before about the anomaly of third influence. And as you know, Michael the first calendar is June 5th, you know, June 30th. Surely, from a business perspective, be a lot cheaper to actually administer having the same level of third throughout the area you're serving your service. So, Liverpool example, which was great, but it was the cheapest. It didn't reflect little awesome talents, far from it was talents. And the daily ticket was once again Liverpool mode, not St. Helens mode. Now I'm sure that it would be far easier to know that you've sold 1 million tickets at 220, right? As opposed to 300,000 a day, 140,000 or whatever. So consistency of pricing and fairness of pricing for your clients can grow the market and cut your administration costs. So I would ask you to look at that. It's far easier to have one price for within your finances. And that there is big anomalies. And I think my parents are falling.
Just to be clear, when we did the £19 to £15, that was given as a potential risk of about £65,000 a week. That was the risk we took by reducing. That's the worst scenario that I assume. We wouldn't get rid of our passengers in the soon we wouldn't. We just have the same number of passengers. So you've got to realise that is a massive risk for us. So what we've been doing is, we did a £15 ticket, we did the £4 ticket, we took part, actually the £2 my ticket,
wouldn't have, a risk or a loss wouldn't have gone on for very long. So I, whilst initially it was a risk, there's no risk now, otherwise you wouldn't have continued it and you wouldn't be looking at reducing it further. But you mentioned your £4 day ticket. Still has no reflection in some areas, your £4 day ticket. Your weekly ticket, people haven't got the money to lay out for a full weekly ticket now. That is why my ticket has been such a success, where the kids are concerned. They was going to school 2 days a week because they couldn't afford the bus fare at the initial start of the week to buy a weekly ticket. So consistency and practice is crucial, and it's looking at your market. You're in an area of deprivation, an area of high unemployment, whilst it is increasing, but it is still highly unemployment and low income families. So daily is crucial.
We are looking at these things all the time. We are seeing some successes with reducing prices. We can't do it all at once. That's the only way I can answer it.
Mary?
Hello. My question isn't about child's fare, children's fares, child fares. But it would be remiss of me not to make a comment. I notice on your 7 priorities going forward, you've missed one off, you know, when you printed it. The 8th priority, it probably came about 2 down, was the review of child fares. Because in 2012, you shocked us all to the core when you increased the child fares from half the cost of an adult to 2/3. Just thought it'd be fair of me to remind you of that before I ask you my question. My question's really about the cleanliness regime. Merseytravel told us a lot about the work that they do to keep their trains spotless. How does your regime work? Because I get the bus every day of the week. I quite often get on the bus at Paradise Street at 5:20 to 6. The bus is filthy. It's got the remains of breakfast, lunch, and the start of dinner usually floating around my feet. So how do you deal with that across the patch?
Every night our vehicles get swept, cleaned, locked, inside, upstairs, on double deckers. What we introduced probably 2 years ago, and in fairness, we're probably going to have to have another look at it, is we also have what's called litter pickers that are based in the major bus stations, Paradise Street, Man Island, not in Queen Square, it's too busy, Hyden Bus Station, Boot Bus Station, Speke Airport, and what they do between certain times, between 12 and 3, is they just go on every single bus that's on there and try and get them before the afternoon peak. Now, I'm not going to stand here and say that they can get every single bus, but they certainly try their best to get as many of the buses coming into the city before they go back out in the evening peak. Because we find that picking up newspapers from the hospital from left in the morning. But certainly, we pay for about probably 6 or 7 litter pickers during the day between 12 and 3.
Thanks for that, Howard. Can I just ask a quick point? Was the bullet point missed off? Bullet point 8?
Yeah, it just fell off the bottom end.
Thanks, Joe. Can I echo comments from my, before my colleagues that I welcome the presentation today? You mentioned during your presentation about being the largest operator, and yet there are some areas whereby you do very few, or if any, services, and I'm particularly
stagecoach, so unfortunately, because of the competition rules, we were told that we couldn't operate in that area for a certain period of time. Now, I have to say that certain period of time has elapsed, so there would be nothing stopping us going into Kirby at the moment, if that's what we wanted to do. But probably the honest answer at the moment is we've still got a lot of work to do on our own network before we start entering into other areas of Liverpool.
Yeah, absolutely.
I understand what you're saying, because it's only about the rationale about the regulation, it's about providing that competition. You're not providing that competition. It's taking care of other areas. But it's it's hard to look at it. And when you do look at it, you might think about one of the things that Stagecoach are doing was they've introduced express services from Kirby and Preston, Chester and Liverpool. I was wondering whether you think about introducing them at the same time.
I think it's fair to say that we've looked at certain express services over various parts of the country, not just Merseyside, in Manchester and in Wales. And where we think there's definitely a market, then we would certainly look at it. I think with express services, what we have to remember is they're either limited stock or they tend to go the quickest way, which means that they either miss parts of the route out, which upset people, or don't stop at certain bus stops, which also upsets people. So unless you're doing an express service on top of commercial service, then that's going to be quite hard to justify in certain areas, but not everywhere, because we do want on the 420 in the morning, we do a West Kirby to Liverpool. At the moment, there's an express service on the 437, which goes down the motorway, and that works well. So we do try them, but in the main, we tend to stick to high frequency services. But it never stops us looking.
Okay. Next, we've got Dan, we've got John Fall, and John Stubbs, and Mark.
Thanks for the presentation. We know that cycling rates have more than doubled in recent years. Stagecoach recently started to train their drivers around safe driving around cyclists. What are we going to do about this?
Well, it's been in our training program for the last 5 years, so our driving make any new starters aware of the importance of cyclists. Also, we work with the Merseyside Organisation for Cyclists. They get involved with our police department. Clett Atkinson is based in Google, and she deals with them. In fact, they provide the literature that goes into our training pack. So all our new starters, and also our existing drivers, because we actually put it as part of the CPC training that's mandatory for all new drivers, all staff hold PCB license. So one of the programmes actually has in it a part on cyclists and the importance of that.
John, Paul.
Thanks, Chair. That's you, Mr. Farrall. We're under statutory obligations to have an integrated transport network and have a modal shift to put people on those sustainable forms of transport as possible. Therefore, we're not your enemy. We are ready to grow your business and to grow a part of the public sector network. There are lots of criticisms from members of the authority, but that's only a snapshot of the complaints of members of the public. So what we're doing is relaying them to you to make sure that you can deliver the best service that you can. Your colleagues were here earlier telling us how experienced Dutch Barn is and Arriva within Dutch Barn, and all the expertise, and it's leading this and leading that in all of the sectors, or many of the sectors and geographies it operates from. These criticisms that we've relayed to you, it suggests to me that you might have quite a lot of learning to do from the organisation. So what kinds of structures are there to share best practice within Arriva? Because one of our concerns is we look at Arriva Northwest and Wales, and particularly Merseyside, what mechanisms are there for you to have within your own corporation, not in addition to the prison system that we relate to you? And the second thing is, colleagues have mentioned how we would say competition in many ways is failing on Merseyside. And we'd say nationally that the market's not working at all. And you might have been directors made reference to London and said how fantastic the London transport system is. Do you recommend and welcome that move to new regulation?
That's your first question. I've been in the industry for 35 years. I learn something new every day. So I think it's wrong that people think that they know everything, but they don't. I don't see you as my enemy. I think we work together extremely well. We don't always agree, but you know, that's healthy at times. I think as far as best practice is concerned, we meet on a regular 3 months with the rest of the group. We share as MDs what's worked, what hasn't worked, and we take that away and we learn from it. There are different territories, what may work in the shires where it's a rural community, may not work in an urban area like Merseyside. But you know, there are areas around the country where we do learn from each other. One of them is Sapphire, where it was tried and tested in Yorkshire and worked. That's been rolled out in Chester, it's been rolled out in Manchester, it will come to Merseyside. So again, that's an example of trying to give the customer a better service, hopefully. So they're the sort of things that we learn every time we go to meetings. As far as re-regulation is concerned, my personal view is that I think it works better. Partnership. I think that there are a number of hurdles that have to be gone through. I think that at the end of the day, by working together, and also for us again to accept that there are a lot of things that we can do better, and I just hope that we get that opportunity to be able to do those things. And then perhaps in 3 or 4 years' time, further down the road, we will have proven to you working in partnership is a better way to go about it. But new regulation doesn't frighten us, you know, because obviously we've got a lot of experience on it right throughout Deutsche Bahn. We just think it's a better way of doing it.
Thanks for that, Chair.
This is my worry is, and I think it's worry shared by other people, that unless operators can demonstrate, regardless who's in government, there is some legislation on the books at the moment. So, you know, as things stand, there are different ways, there could be potentially different ways to operate that hurdles are overcome. But I've not really noticed any difference. And I'm a bus user in the operation of Arriva since it's acquired by Deutsche Bahn. So you mentioned sharing expertise within the UK group and possibly within Arriva. But my question was essentially about, you know, which expertise and which best practice do you share with other countries within the group, and countries that tend to do public transport better than us? Because if that isn't shared and service doesn't improve, then there is a risk that re-regulation will be around the corner.
Yeah, I'll take your point. I think we will bear in mind in Europe. Quite a few of the countries where we operate are actually regulated. So it's difficult to take best practice in a regulated market. It's just like us learning from London because everything is regulated in London. I think if you look at 2010, I would argue Arriva has changed a lot since Deutsche Bahn actually took us over. I think the investment has been speeded up. I think if you look at next year, Merseyside is the only company in the whole group that is getting new vehicles, new double decks next year. No other company in Britain is getting that, as far as Arriva is concerned. And I think that shows a big commitment to it's got, you know, new leather seats. Wi-Fi is a big thing for the public nowadays. It's all about communication. People want talk all the time on the phones. That's what they do. That's what passengers tell us they want. So I think as far as ticket machines, £3 million going into ticket machines. When you look at the investment in property, there's a new garage in Rill, there's a new one in Birkenhead, there's a new one in Speak that went in 2 years, 3 years ago. So again, I think that where we were a bit sort of concerned about the takeover, it's certainly been proven in the last couple of years that the investment that they've given into Merseyside has been massive. So I've certainly seen a change.
John?
Thanks. I'm grateful for the investment, the answer, but I have to say, and what's been said by my colleague, who is obviously telepathic, there has been considerable investment in it doesn't necessarily mean that there's been improvement in service. And in terms of coordinating and integration, I think they're the lessons, whether it's an integrated market or it's not. In order to grow passengers, then we need to integrate timetables.
I just couldn't agree with you more. I think, unfortunately, if you look at Queen Square bus station as an example, it is probably, I think it's the second busiest outside of London. Train station is away from it, and I think certainly we've gone through and seen, you know, hopefully in 20 years to come, what you want is a train station and outside you want the bus station. You want what you own, because if people have to walk or don't know where they're going, you won't get that bus load of change. So I absolutely agree.
Okay, we've got John Stockton next, then Mark, then Ron again, Les, and I'll come in.
Thanks very much, and thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you. I'm one of the representatives here for Halton's big guest marketing. I'd like my questions to do with my ticket. I'm just wondering in Halton when it's likely this service is going to be extended to Halton so that even people of Halton can actually get here for this excellent service. So just like your comments from that in terms of just what's the time for everything you're actually going to use. Thank you very much.
Well, I think Phil said before is that I'm still learning. I think we gave assurances that from probably March we would know the answers. So I'm going to stick my neck on the line and say March.
Thank you, Phil. We'll hold you to that.
Oh, March 15th.
Mark.
Thanks, Chair. Apologies, first of all, for me. Two relatively straightforward questions from me around basically how you engage and consult with your customers. I'm sure you'll appreciate that social media and the internet become more relevant to both customers and operators. And in relation to Twitter specifically, do you have a policy as to what purposes Twitter via your Twitter profile and how you engage with the customers through your Twitter profile? More engaging with that, like some other transport operators are. And the second point that I wanted to raise was your website, as far as your potential, what's the purpose of your website when it comes to the engagement with your customers? Certainly, as far as I'm concerned, I would see it as a way of relaying information and ultimately encouraging greater patronage on your buses. Will raise
Twitter one, it's a fairly new adventure for us. We've got a team set up in Asia at the moment. I think for us, the idea behind Twitter is to be able to respond to our customers really quickly. So if you've got questions about a particular service, whether it's a diversion, whether it's a road closure, or whether it's just general information or a complaint, it's that we're able to deal with it a lot better than how we deal with some of the customer complaints at the moment. Go through a central team. So I think that for us is we're able to give a bit more on the customer service side. far as the website, I'm not an IT expert. I don't like the website, I have to be honest with you. I think there's got a lot to do yet. And a website for an operator that doesn't give fares on its website, I think it's just nonsense. We've made our shout at the leadership meetings. It's supposed to be there to be able to be easy to use, encourage people to travel, to see what offers are there, to keep them, to make sure that they keep coming back, to make sure they check the offers, and also to get them to use the services and have confidence in it. At the moment, if I'm going to be slightly honest, we're not there, and I think there's got to be a lot more work done on how we promote the website. But I think it's getting there, but at the moment it's only given about 70% of the information. So I think there's a lot missing. I'll probably get kicked for saying that.
Following on from one set, does that mean perhaps we could see some changes to the website and some improved information on the networks?
Well, I'll tell you what made me laugh when we went to the marketing meeting and showed us some of this stuff. One question we asked was, have you shown any of the customers? We've asked, because it's no point asking me. Now I don't use the website, I don't use the computer if I have to. So there's no point showing me. Have you been out? Have you asked the customers what they want, what information they want? So I'm hoping in the next 6 months we'll see a big change. And hopefully they'll start thinking about the customers' sort of perception of the website, rather than how we feel about it. Because it makes no odds, right? Right, how you feel.
Got Ron again, then Les, then Arlen again.
Once again, thank you, Carol. Well, just on your website, you don't know how I decided to use the website. I found quite a difference. It's effective script. I've actually accessed it out to the cost for one of your tickets. And I ended up having to bring Howard up to ask it off to take it one, because I couldn't get the information from anywhere. I've got that there. That's 1 hour's frustration, so I'm applying it. Well, by the way, I have got the app on my phone, so I'll have a check with you about this. Just one thing I'd just like to bring up, I know we're looking at trying to be competitive and stuff like that, trying to integrate the service, but you do really competition, so that's the reality. You really have the competition for the traffic that travels across the world, the Liverpool money, it's a substantial amount. Travel from that world, rising even shopping away and so forth. The big disparity in the cost of your travel compared to what it costs on the ferry, compared to what it costs on the train. And the problem is you've got a large area of the world, captive audience, they have no other option to get on your buses. And you need to look at seriously, look at the fare levels you charge for people coming across. Particularly from Hampton Square and close to the front, paying £3 service ticket, but if the equivalent is £2.70 on the train, there's a big difference between big. So you're not competitive, you have to be a car selling one place or whatever. So I think I would ask you to not take that seriously. You've got the whole price structure in the world, and certain other areas as well.
When can we have the Cross River services looked at, the fare structure? Genuinely, because it's the most expensive way across the river.
Well, you say that, but it's still £15 for a weekly ticket, which is as cheap as it is in Liverpool or anywhere else. However, I'll give you a promise. As well as St Helens, we're doing a lot of work in Southport at the moment, but Southport, St Helens and Virginia are the three areas looking at the fares in the next 6 months. There you go. Will, it says Will. Oh, I said Will. I meant Will.
It's going to be a busy run up till June, Ron. There's lots of things we'll be expecting news on. Les, you're next.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Howard, for the presentation. There's some exciting stuff going on there. also, it's been a long time since we've looked at late night buses through the tunnel. What's happened is there's a lot of changes that's gone on over the last few years. There's a pool of people piling out the clubs, and there's an army of people standing at the end of the tunnel trying to get through every night, especially at the weekends, and especially coming up over Christmas. My course is one of them. The taxis will not come across for whatever reasons. They just refuse to come across. And even when you book taxis out of town, you don't take them, or they're swiped by somebody else. I think it's about time. Could you have another look at whether it's feasible to put late night buses back on? Now, I feel that times have changed so much that there is the opportunity there to grow the business and to start putting some late night buses, even if it's just timed ones when the bus is breaking up and so forth.
I'll give you a brief history on late night buses. It's very brief. We used to run a very big network of night services from Speed, Boom, all over, including the world. And when the licensing laws changed from 2 o'clock to 24 hours, what we found is that when they were at 2 o'clock, the taxis couldn't cope with the volume of people at Liverpool. So everyone came out at 2 o'clock, and that's why all the night services did very well. What's happened now is, since licensing laws have changed, there's been a big spread. So what's happened is the taxis can now cope a lot better, which meant that the demand for bus services dropped a hell of a lot. And slowly, one by one, that network eroded because of the fact they can cope. Now, if you go out to Liverpool, you see people at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, even 5 o'clock. I don't know whether you're aware or not, but we're doing a trial at the moment with Merseytravel and the police, where we're doing the four Saturdays leading up to Christmas. We've done two, where we're actually doing night services. Now, I don't think we're doing the Whirling Fairs, because I think there's already a commercial operation that does the Whirling. So I don't know why the doors are getting stuck, because there is a night bus on. I'm looking at Frank, because I'm not 100% certain. But we are doing a trial operation at the moment on the
Liverpool. Who does that chair?
Ace travel.
We have another look here?
Yeah, of course.
And I think it's important to say as well about the Christmas ones we're doing. We've also got a very competitive fare structure, £2 to get home on those services, which is more of what we would expect. In terms of questions I was going to ask Howard, I think it's encouraging the way that you're acknowledging the short hop issue, but that's a massive issue for us. It's encouraging that you're going to be doing a 150 in the Wirral. I think the thing that I would sort of ask is that why aren't you looking at doing it right across the patch? And the reason I say that, I know I've heard about how it's a risk to your business, but in a number of places across the country where you operate, like West Yorkshire, for example, where it's 120, the North East, where it's 130, you're doing it there, and you've been doing it there for years. So obviously you must be able to kind of account how it works there, and why not be able to do that here. I don't really see it being such a risk when you're actually doing it in another part of the country.
Okay, I'll give you a little bit of a history lesson. It used to be two fares in Merseyside. There was a short fare of £1 and there was a longer distance fare of £1.80. And there was no doubt, after we went before my time, there was no doubt that the majority of passengers were actually buying £1 and £1.80. Now, you could argue that's our responsibility, we should be checking the fares. But we don't have a cheap respect. When we introduced flat fare, which was originally, I think, about 2006 or 7, whatever it was, the flat fare actually worked and made everyone buy it. So the idea of the flat fare is to keep it simple. So that's why one of the reasons, the main reason, riding. Now, I accept, I think we've had these conversations before, that flat fare only works if it's going to encourage people to use it. £2.20 will not encourage your homes to use it. And that's why the trialing rule, so it's a contained area, because Phil has talked about the risk going from 19 to 15, it will be a similar amount of money. It will be a risk of about £60,000-£70,000 a week. Is it still a large amount of revenue at risk? So if we do the will, we can contain it. If it works, we don't get the overriding issues, we can then roll it out to other areas. It just has to be a little bit, because we're a private company, could be a little bit careful with this.
No, I appreciate that, but you're obviously managing it in the northeast, for example, or in Wakefield, because that's, you've got that fair structure there. You've obviously got a revenue protection regime there that works. Why not just take the template and use it across the whole of the city?
Well, I think different areas have different fare scales. I mean, I know for a fact in Midlands there's a pound single fare as well. But I also know in the Shires and Southern Counties it's £2.40. So I think, you know, it may be due to history, it may be just due to the where you are in the particular regions, but you know, we are where we are. We've had a flat fare for the last sort of 8-9 years. Is it time to move away from that flat fare? Yes, I would say it is, but I think we've got to do it in a controlled way. I don't think we can simply just say, let's put it at 120 because it works in the northeast, because it's different businesses.
Well, I think we might have to agree to disagree, but I'll be looking forward to your timetable that I'm going to roll out that approach across the city which. And I think it's just important to lay the point why we get so hung up on single fare. I know in your presentation you talked about the fact it's only 9% of customers. Marlene, Ron, a variety of other members made those really, really vital number one priority for our citizens. But we're not just a gang of, and excuse my language, tight arses and bleeding hearts on this. Actually, we've got the interest of your business and the wider bus network very much at heart as well. And coming back to my original point about growing the network, what we do know is there's the potential to double the amount of people using public transport here. Take a bit of work, but we know that those people who have converted before, we then have to start cracking the nuts of those people who are more challenging in terms of car drivers. The only way we're going to be able to do that, however, is thinking about how they're going to enter the bus industry. And that will be on a single fare. You know, if you're thinking about giving it a go, you're going to jump on the bus and ask for a single ticket. You're not going to ask for a weekly ticket. Because actually, why would you try something with that longer term commitment? Just like if I went over the road to Tesco and thought, I fancy trying a different loaf of bread, I'll just buy one of them. I won't buy three for one offer, because I don't know if I like it. So that's why we really get hung up on it. Yes, it's all about affordability for our local people, but it's just as much about the long-term sustainability of the network, which you've got a key business imperative to that as well. The question I was going to ask, and just picking up on something that you said before, is you thought that the kind of flat fare had reached its peak. From that, can I presume there's going to be no increases in that in the next year?
You really are putting me on the spot now, aren't you? I think it's a conversation that we've had as directors on where we are at the moment. Could I hand on heart and stand in and say to you all, there won't be any fare increases in April? No. Could I say that the flat fare may go up? I don't know, is the answer there. What I can tell you is that we are incredibly, well, as we are all agreed, I think, that we are trying our best to hold £15.4. Because a lot of our customers buy the weekly and the day. I agree with your sentiments, and I agree with Ron's. I do think eventually, you know, we have a kid's fare scale that is under 16, so as soon as they reach 16, 17, it's no wonder they buy a car because they're able to pay adult fare. I do believe that the buying ticket will change, not my honest opinion. I think it will move in stages. I think it will go to 17. And I think kids first will come under 18. That's my own personal view. As far as the single fares, I can give you a commitment that we will be looking at the short hopper fares. Yes, in Birkenhead initially, but again, we talked about St Helens, we talked about other areas of Liverpool as well. And we are trying things, we have been trying things for the last 18 months to see whether or not they work or not. It is important, I do agree with you, that we are trying to grow the revenue. It's very important to us as well as it is to you. But I think we've just got to be aware that there's always a risk when you reduce fares. We listened to First Group about what they did in the country about slashing fares by 20%. And now, you know, 12 months later, they're putting the fares up because they're not able to grow the market by 20%. Because otherwise, if they're only growing the market, yes, it sounds great, you grow patronage by 8%. But if you cut your fares by 20%, it would take a genius to work out if it's the wrong move. So, you know, it's important as a business because we still have to make, you know, profit at the end of the day because we have to reinvest. So it's important for us, you know, to try and do it in stages. But I recognise that it isn't just about the meeting, it isn't just about the day ticket. I think we've seen that in the My Ticket. 25,000 a week is a phenomenal amount of sales. Even if you forget what it's doing about with the offers, which means that kids can actually afford to go to school, which is vitally important. So I think the short hopper is going to be the answer. And you can have my assurances that certainly we're looking at one guarantee in April. Certainly by the end of next year,
we'll
be rolled out in other places as well.
Okay, well, we'll look forward to that timescale as well. Another question I was going to pick up on, you mentioned about bus priorities, and we agree with that entirely. I know you made mention about the bus lanes in Liverpool, and as you'll know, that isn't a removal of priority, it's going to be a change of priority. It's going to be a move towards red routes, it's going to be a change on traffic circles, so it'll be a different type of priority. One of the things that's interested me talking to colleagues in other parts of the country is how different operators have been prepared to put their hand in their pocket to help fund different bus enhancements. For example, I know Stagecoach are investing some park and ride sites in Greater Manchester. I know in the West Midlands they've kept a fund to be able to fund priority measures. In a time when the public sector is particularly constrained financially, is that something you'd be open to do?
Well, I'd like to think, given what we've done, BBAs, given what we've done with the BBA that we've worked on, that, you know, we wouldn't say no to anything. It depends, again, it goes on the benefits. If there was long term benefits for us, then you know, I think we'd be daft not to look at it. I think, you know, you talk about red routes and you know, other types of bus priorities, they are important. What people want is to be able to get to A to B as quick as possible. And also, I think we have a recognition that, you know, it's not just about buses, it is about it is about other modes, it is about cyclists and about other modes. This isn't all about buses, it's about a joined up approach, I think it's important. So, you know, I think we would be only too willing to sit down and talk. But again, there's got to be some sort of commitment from other parties, because you've seen what we've committed to the BPAs, unfortunately. That didn't work for whatever reason. We committed all our part of it. So yes, that's why I listened to you. I think there's got to be a commitment from all sides that we are prepared to sit down and talk, and even talk about, you know, the finances. We would want some firm commitments that there was going to be benefits for us.
I'm not sure we'd have to have that dialogue, of course. I'm conscious it's been a really long session for you. Thanks ever so much for your presentation. And monthly dealing with the questions, particularly when Phil had to get off. As finalising points though, how if you've been able to hear passionately from right across the committee how there's a number of very, very key issues we feel need to be addressed. And we're pleased about some of the reassurances you've given us, but there's also been a lot of saying that we'll take things away and we'll understand that you need the time to be able to do that. But I do really need to lay the point. You do need to take those things away, look at them, think about how they can be addressed, and if you don't think they can be addressed with what we suggest, come back with better alternatives for us. Because what we do want is a partnership working, in which we're both proactive, and we're both coming to the table. with ideas that significantly improve things. The travelling public can get more questions. But thanks ever so much for the presentation. And, I'm sure we look forward to some of the plans you bring forward.
Thank you, everyone. I'll be quite happy to come back in 12 months' time and find the questions at me again.
You'll be back in March, to be honest, with my ticket and 18. Thanks, Dad. I appreciate that. It was a long session. We were nearly going home on one of those night buses, weren't we, Les? If we want to move on then, item 8 is the environmental policy, Steve.
Thank you, Chair. This is quite short, but something that we do annually is we review our environmental policy and the approach we're going to take to reduce the impact of our operations and also how we work with partners. Some examples of Arriva and how we're going to work with people like that to help improve the environment across the design. The aim of the policy is really to support legal compliance and make sure that we're ensuring that the work we undertake with the legislation that is appropriate to those operations. It's part of our ISO 14001 environmental management standards system that we get audited to every year. Also supports things like the new LTP or transport plan for growth, city, region, low carbon economy aspects, and also support efficiency within Merseytravel in terms of the way we operate, particularly in terms of, for example, energy costs, carbon savings, and CRC, carbon reduction. It's only a short document. What it really does is kind of identify where we have two roles, our own internal management that we can't have direct control of, but also the role we play in the city region in terms of supporting partners, looking at things where we have more influence than direct control. Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Are we all sorted out? Okay. If we're okay, then to consider that report, it's recommendations paragraph 2 of the report. That's agreed. Excellent. Item number 9 is the local sustainable transport fund, course 2 of the report.
Thanks, Chair. It's just a question of clarification. I may have misunderstood the data presented before us. For example, on page 40, when allocating budget spend for some calories, it says £0. But on the back page, on page 45, it says £45. Now, it might be below a threshold, so that's what it's such a small number. But then when I look at some of the other figures, some match. And some don't.
The table as an entity on page 45 is the overall budget for the whole of 4 years for the programme. What we've indicated within the report is just the budget for this financial year being the final year of the programme.
That's helpful, thanks, Jeff.
That's great. Tony?
Yeah, again, just for clarification, similar to.
that case, if the move recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed. Item 10 is the fees and charges review for 2015-16. Dave and Gary are dealing with this.
Thank you, Chair. And the issue really is a continuation of what we started in 2014 in the cycle. It's trying to bring a combined paper to you that shows you what we're trying to do with income having rates for our own services. And this is a key element of the medium-term financial strategy. We haven't only talked about cost savings we can make by becoming more efficient, we're also looking at areas where we think we can raise more income from the services we want as well. It's like balancing that between. The key ones we put in here really are to look at pricing change over Mersey ferries, which is detailed in the appendix behind that. Overall, we think that generates something between £130,000 that can be used to reduce the ferries deficit. There's also a look at supported bus fares, where we've looked at the charge that we currently charge on our supported services. And whilst how it's gone now, we can say we don't want to go to we do recognise that our bus fares are significantly lower, and we're asking for 20 increase on charge and adding a further one. That should generate somewhere between £600,000 again to reduce the requirement for next year's rate. As well as just increasing the prices, we are going to put the pricing structure and keeping the forces some effect stage up with the prices as well. But that would be looked back in the future strategy. Final item was to look at departure charges that we get from bus operators for our facilities. We are increasing those this year. It won't generate an awful lot of money, but we think it's vital to do that because our departure charges are still considerably lower than our competitors in the BTE areas. Because of the amount of work that's going on in Queen's Square, or programmes going on in Queen's Square this year, that's only likely to generate for completeness, there's a note on the tolls. That basically says we're not going to do anything until that further papers will be sent to you in the future. And just to bring up the prepaid ticket price increases that have already been particularly busy and have already been approved. I think it's key in that as well. We've talked an awful lot today about my ticket. There's no plans to increase my ticket. It's still a trial, we're still going to review that trial. Howard's right, in terms of ticket numbers, we think it's averaging about 31,000 tickets per week, of which Arriva usually gets something reasonable, 25,000 to 26,000 plus tickets. So from our point of view, it's been a great success in encouraging more use of children and getting them to use our tickets. Overall, the price increases, fares increases included in the paper, will generate something in the region of £770,000 that we currently are using to support a gap in next year's levy. And that's why we're looking to continue to ask you to fund them. So, any questions, I'll see if I can answer them for you.
Thanks, Dave. I think we agree entirely that my team has been a very good success. I've got Ron and then I've got Les.
Thank you.
that's always been a bugbear when we talk about allocating time, because we get assured we pay for it, we are an operator or a light bulb. Council has been quite often considerably low in the other average fares within that box, so it just causes issues with the operator.
Les? Thanks, Chair. Just
something that we could consider and look at.
I see a few nodding heads and I see a few shaking heads.
So it is a concern because that is a considerable leap. And if you're a young single mum with a child and you're getting on the bus and it's gone from 50 to 70p, that is a huge ask. Sorry, colleagues, but that is a good ask.
I think the second question, just before we finish, the second question is about the Merseytravel. It's actually showing a deficit. 2.5 million there. That question's not been addressed this afternoon either. I'm just wondering what plans there are in place to actually address that particular deficit. Thank you very much.
Dave, do you want to come back on that and I'll come back with you guys?
In terms of the Merseytravel, there is currently, or I'm going to start fairly shortly, a Merseytravel long-term strategy. In terms of price increases, I'll fully take your point on the 20p increase. We felt as a group that it was justifying putting the result given the level of current commercial average fares to about 30 half fares were 190. The differential was causing a problem between us and the commercial operator. I agree it's not something we should consider to just increase every year like that. I think it's going to be much more than we have done between now and the next year, and being able to some sort of fair offer price that's been talked about.
Yeah, and if I can just come in there as well, take the foreign pass narrative to say a few things about the varying reduction programme that we've been dealing with in terms of deficit reduction. I think we've also got to take note of the very powerful state of public finances and the fact that so many cuts that come down the road by local government to ourselves, and one of the reasons we're having to make the kind of changes on our own supportive fare structure is purely to try to offset some of the money that we have to put into supportive buses. So I think that's an important point to remember. I think you're exactly right, Dave, and it's very prescient following on from the debate and discussion we had with the REIT beforehand. We know that a flat fare policy doesn't deliver the right thing for bus users across the city region, so it's entirely right that we look at a fair stage approach for our services as well. I think we look forward to the next months, into the next year, of how potentially we could develop something like that accordingly. Gary, do you want to tell us a bit more about the deficit reduction programme on ferries?
The deficit programme, what Dave has already said, we commissioned and we're asking for tunnels. Specifically looking at the services that the house rent, the commuter service, and really exploring the market that you're looking at. But also its assets, the vessels, the terminals, just to make sure we can drive operational efficiency as much as possible, both from a revenue perspective, but also from a program perspective as well. And that's building.
Thanks, Chair. It's pretty much echoing your comments as Chair. This organisation is funded by a levy on the districts and the council taxpayers. It's funded through direct government grants and it's funded by a levy on passengers. Unfortunately, after 4 years of failed Tory austerity, we're supposed to be facing a budget balance nationally next year, but we are not. They have increased public debt considerably, which means austerity from now until 2020. That means that those least able to afford fees have to come from the cost, unfortunately. The money has to come from somewhere, and a decision was made in Whitehall that it's least able to pay. We've got to make a difference.
Saving the chair, there will be no increase in the levy of this organisation.
Thanks, Chair. That's what I was really getting at because, you know, the large customers within Merseyside would end up, you know, coming in 770,000 and be walking on the levy. So, you know, I'm missing it.
No further
questions or comments. If I can then move the recommendation of the 2 of the report. Nearly there, folks. Item 11 is the smart ticketing update report for November, and Gary's presenting. Questions or comments? Rob, then Gordon, then Les.
Thank you.
perhaps if you take that conversation a bit later on, because I think it will obviously depend on the individual passenger, and obviously Travel Line is the best place to give people not only journey advice but also ticketing advice on what is the best product, but the value in terms of accessibility. Got less than I've got now.
Thanks, Chair. Just to end on a good note, Gary, I just offered the opportunity to say thank you to you and the team for rolling out the smart ticketing. It has been a mammoth task, a lot of work to put on behind it. I think the decision to do work as a pilot has brought those anomalies up on you, and thank you for handling those and correcting those swiftly so we're able to move on at this point.
Thanks, Jim. Just a quick example of there are an awful lot of people that want to buy a sailaway the day before because they do not live near a pay point. So that if they have to get up in the morning, get on the bus, don't have a sailaway. They have to get on the bus to get to, you know, the pay point.
But I think genuinely that's why it's great that we have paired up with PayPod, because we're going through a situation by which the amount of outlets, not just in the world but across the city region, will travel. So actually many more people will be much closer to a PayPod place to buy one of our tickets than they were.
800 outlets.
Very happy Christmas and New Year. I look forward to seeing you all in January.